Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And very good morning. Today we're going to discuss on mosque. Yeah? Actually, this is an outstanding lecture that we should be that should be delivered 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, before your semester breaks. Okay. Next. Okay. Today we're going to discuss mosque from three different perspectives. One is from the building perspective, which is your favorite topics. We talk about the architectural of the mosque. The second one, we're going to discuss about the institution of the mosque. And the third one, we're going to discuss about the role of the mosque as a community development center. So those are the three issues that we're going to discuss today. So it's a quite a long presentation, and I believe it's already available on your YouTube, on your Facebook, the slides. Okay, thanks. As you can see that, there are three types of contents. One is mosque as a building typologies. Second one, we'll discuss about mosque as institution and community centers. And the third one, we'll discuss about how we can reconstruct the idea of mosque and Islamic architectures in general. Okay, thanks. Okay, this is the Prophet's mosque. Yeah? If you're referring to the books by Hasan bin Khan. Mosque, cultural and traditional setting, something like that. It talks about what's actually a mosque. So if you refer to that book, this is the reconstruction of the Prophet's mosque. So, next. Yeah. That is the sketchup, the sketch that people in architecture books was providing. But this is the sketches that not many architecture books display. Ya tadi itu, you will see in a lot of architecture books. But this one, you won't find it in many architecture books. So, can you go to the previous one? So, if you're looking at this one, it's basically it's a building. Mosque is a building. This is the Prophet mosque. So, if you ask me, what is the original form of the mosque? That is the original form of the mosque. One, you don't have any roof. The one at the side is actually this side. This actually is the Prophet mosque, a Prophet house adjacent to the mosque. And you have the Sufa, this is called the Sufa's areas, when the companion of the Prophet is actually staying there to learn more about Islam. Okay? Next. This sketch is very important. Why? Because it shows what activities actually happening in the mosque. Okay. Somebody is giving a lecture, so you see ada lembu, ada kambing masuk dalam mosque. You have a market beside the mosque, because if you read the histories, there's one time the Prophet is opening a market, and there's a time when the Prophet was opening hospitals inside the mosque. And there was a time when the non-Muslim people was entering the mosque during that time. Okay. So these sketches display a more life event what actually happening during that time. Okay. Starting from that original form of the mosque, when the mosque goes to different part of the world, it changed the forms following the existing architecture within that area. Okay. Well, in some countries like Middle East, they call it an hypostyle typology. Hypostyle was referring to the area where you have lots of columns. They call it the trees of columns, the forest of columns beside the buildings. And in some countries like Africa, you have those kind of typologies. When you use a mud construction, they call it mud constructions. Konstruksi lumpur, adobe. They use a lumpur. They use the adobe as a part of the designs, materials for the mosque. If you go to the Central Asia or some part of Europe, like Turkey, they have a lot of traditions of domes. Or from the stone, when they cut the stone, they make it as a domes. So you find a lot of this type of dome, as you can see in some of the mosques in Malaysia, like Masjid Wilayah, Masjid UTM, you will find those kind of typology form of the mosque. When you go to the Iran, central part of the Asia, you will find those kind of typologies. So you have four type of dome, like the one in Isfahan. You will find four type of dome, and you have an open space as a praying space. So still, the praying space was open. You don't have any roof. If you go to India, like this one, what called Indian typologies, where you introduce it to the onion dome, the new type of typologies. We did that. But it was very different if you go to the China and if you go to Nusantara. You will see that type. Some of you already worked on that type of mosque. And you have also have Nusantara type when you have three tiers of mosque. Okay, thanks. Yeah, they're just giving you a sample of the mosque. In Damascus, in Tunisia, Great Mosque of Cordoba, Jene Mosque in Africa. This is when you go to the central, to the Turkey. This is a Hagia Sophia. Hagia Sophia, as you know, is not a mosque. It's a church. Now they change into mosque. Now it become a museum. When you go there, it becomes a museum. It's no longer, people are no longer praying there. So they use Sinan, one of the great architects in Turkey. They use the typologies of Hagia Sophia as a one of the forms or typology of mosque in Turkey. If you go to UTM mosque, you will have that type of minarets, the minarets and also the domes. Okay, next, Iranian typologies. Iranian typologies you will introduce into the, they call it Iwan, Iwan Gate. If you go to the Putra Mosque in Putrajaya, you will have this gate at the entrance of the mosque. Previously, those gate was actually used as a madrasa. When you have a madrasa, you have Islamic lectures or classes. You will have it at the downstairs of that domes. At the class dekat bawah tu. Okay, next. This is the different type of mosque in Iran, in Isfahan, in Uzbekistan, who have this Iwan gate, yeah? The big Iwan gate, the pointed arch spaces there. Okay, Indian typologies, you have the onion domes. Some of them are next. Some of them was used in our in Kuala Lumpur as a railway stations, and some of them we call it mogul architecture. Plans in Lahore, also in Pakistan, they have the same typologies of mosques. This is the Chinese typologies. I was having an opportunity to visit the Xi'an Great Mosque in Xi'an. So it follows the local architectures of that particular place. Yeah, next. And this is some in Guangzhou. In New Jia in Beijing. So I also have a chance to visit that mosque in Hangzhou and next. And also the Nusantara. This is a mosque in Padang, in West Sumatra, Masjid Limau. Do you know this mosque? Ada tak? Yang besar. Masjid Demak, yang dua ini dekat Padang, dekat Sumatera Barat. Yang ini dekat apa yang Nusa Tenggara. Okay, next. Now we talk about modern mosque, which is your second assignment. When we talk about modern mosque, there's a different type of approach. Different type of approach. So, kalau if you see in the previous sample of the mosque, Did you find any specific regulation of mosques? Ada tak specific regulation of mosques? Ambil lah, what is specific regulation? Okay. Should we have those elements in the mosque?
Not necessarily, but it shows like, it differentiates the style of the mosque.
Anyone? From the traditional mosque that I explained before, did you find any specific element that should be in the mosque? Yang wajib ada di dalam masjid. Is there any element? Contoh, dome. Eh? Dome in some of the Middle East, Turkish or Indian or even the Iran, you will have the dome. But if you go to China, you won't find any dome in the mosque. In South Asia, you won't find any dome in the mosque. So, dome is not necessarily to be in the mosque. Yang kedua apa? Minaret. Menara. They call it nar. It's come from the word nar. This is api. So during the previous time, when you don't have the loudspeakers, the mosque committee used that tower to light up a light, apa api, dinyalakan api. So it showed that when the light is on, means that it's a prayer time. But now we have some systems and everything. So the minarets, if you see some of the mosques, they don't have any minaret. What else? So, is there any specific element that should be in the mosque? In one gate, also the same. The gate of Assoc is the same. You don't have to. You shouldn't. In some part of the Iran, yes. In Uzbekistan, in Kazakhstan, you have that gate. But in the different part of the world, you don't have any gate. Alien dome, rumah yang macam bawang, kan? Also the same. The wall. Yang tebal, yang tinggi dinding kan, so, tak ada juga. Ornamentation also the same. If you looking at the ornamentation, some mosques in Middle East, they use the calligraphy. If you go to the Xi'an mosque, they use the calligraphic of Quran in the wall. And the ayat Quran was crafted in the wall. So the whole wall was actually is a Quran written by in the woods, in the timber. But if you go in some other part of the world. If you go to Bali, yeah. Anyone been to Bali and visit the Nurul Iman Mosque in Bali? They use dragon. Dragon jadi dia punya dinding. Tak pernah tengok kan? Oh. One day in Balkis coming from the Bali, yes. Balkis, I hope you listen to this one. She need show us some of the mosques in Bali lah. Because they merge between the Hindus in Bali and the mosque. And you have a picture of human at the gate. Ada gambar orang. Saya tengok, oh lemak, tak pernah tengok. So, there will be a very interesting discussion. But, as I said before, in the traditional mosque, you won't find any specific element that should be put in the mosque. So, the question now, when you design a modern mosque, what are you going to do? Well, you design the modern mosque, so people have different type of interpretations. This is some of the approach, yeah, when I did my master and PhD. I was looking at the modern mosque. What are the style and approach that they are using? I think it was published in two books. One is Dewan Bahasa. Second one was UTM publisher in Johor Bahru. Okay, next. What they call it revivalism. Revive means it's not the drinking, yeah. They are revived. Revivalism means when you are fed up or you die, people will revive you again. Hidupkan kembali. Jadi the style happened to be famous during that time, but gone. Then you revive the things. So that was the definition. The direct interpretation of previous Armenian language using the same materials and construction process. Direct application of forms and architectural elements from previous known as architecture using other than the original material and construction process. So it could be both ways. Whether you use the original materials or you are using modern materials. Both we call it revivalism. Okay? Thanks. So if you're referring to different type of the mosque, this is a sample of mosque, which is using the approach for revivalism. The advantage of the revivalism is that one, language is easily recognized, it makes design everlasting imitation. So, but you don't have to provide a new design, you can easily copy it from the past. Direct links, you have a direct link in the past, people can easily, okay, this is a mosque. Because previously it was a mosque, so people can easily recognize things. As the works in Hasan Fathi, this is the work of Hasan Fathi, Egyptian architects. Anyone ever heard Hasan Fathi?
Yes.
Hasan Fathi say, if the buildings, if the temperature inside the buildings 1 degree hotter or higher than the outside, then you make a scene. The architect will make a scene. Kita buat dosa. Jadi kalau you buat bangunan, temperature dalam bangunan satu degree lagi panas itu dekat luar, then you make yang jadi buat dosa. Kita merasa mati. For the people lah. But of course in the winter countries better lah kalau satu lagi ni. So it will be quite besar. So in Hasan Fathi's works, the Brunei, he was using the local language at the same time local architectural material in order to develop the economic of the countries. This is the design. Macam apa traditional lama lah. It's like an order, apa order. Next. This is the disadvantage. Local revivalism doesn't relate the idea of spirit of the time. If you ever learn about the modern architectures, there's a term called spirit of the time and the spirit of the place. So the building should grow. You cannot use the previous one, but using the old language. So you can read them. Expensive efforts. You can have an expensive buildings. The interpretation, so you will have those kind of issues lah in the design. Next. Second one, they call it metaphor. Yeah, the approach of the mosque, they call it metaphor. This is the mosque designed by Basil Al-Bayati, architect Basil Al-Bayati. This one, it's like a Quran. I haven't found this mosque. I think it's a conceptual design. Or another mosque in Pakistan, when they use the khemah. And you have the stage like the Quran. The building designed to communicate a meaning through use of abstraction of an object. So you're referring to the objects, like whether it is a Quran or it is something to do related with Islam as a symbol. Okay, next. The advantage of that form, like this is, he was representing the idea of kurma, kurma trees. Depending on the choice of the objects, metaphor can be a very powerful tool. In Malaysia, you can see lots of buildings using so-called metaphor. Even if you ask the architect will say it. Yeah, so for example, like Kampung Haji, Menara Maybanks, he did some design by Hijaz Kasturi. If you ask Hijaz, there's a one time when we managed to ask Hijaz, is that your opinion, is that the metaphor of this one, a kris? Menara Maybanks, kan, people say it's like a kris. Tabung Haji is like tabung. Then you can see the national libraries, Tempolo, ada Siri Junjung, so lots of object. But if you're the architect, they won't say anything. So, no, I didn't mean that. So same thing when people ask Aerosarinans about the Dallas Airport. It's not like a bird. It's not a bird. It's something else. So it was always like that. So it's normal. So depending on the choice of objects. So it could be very useful, like for example, my symbol of the design cost in Malaysia. This is very good. One of the good sample of the design was the KLIA International Airport, where Kishore Kurokawa was creating using that as a symbol of the airport. It's the airport in the forest and forest inside the airport. Okay, next. But if you are wrongly executing, it creates too obvious. Yeah? Too obvious means people would thought that you keep it too simple. Senang sangat nak dapat the form. It's not that. It's not like you are putting lots of effort in designing the things. That was the things. Okay, next. Can you go back? If the advantage is that if too complex, if it is too complex, then you will people won't understand it. Kalau dia terlalu complex, the message dies with the architects. The architects is just orang yang paham. Like some of the designed by Le Corbusier, people were asking Notre Dame du Havre. Notre Dame du Havre for Conchamps. And you remember the one of the design church by Le Corbusier. People were asking, what is the meaning of the forms? So it's too complex. Nobody dies, the architect dies, only he knows what it means. Some people say people prayers, some people say friendship, some people say it's a lot of things. Yeah. Okay? The third approach that people use when they design a mosque, they call it geometrics, geometricism. This is simple forms. Because Al-Quran is not allowing us to put a symbol of animals or man in the mosque. So the people use these geometrical forms as one of the ornamentations. This is some mosques in Iran and some mosques in, this is what is Canada. So Isna project here, Guzan Haider's project. Use of geometric elements in the overall form of fenestration or ornamentation of the mosque. Okay. Next. This is some temple of the mosque in Bangladesh, some other part of the world. So it's a geometrical basic forms. If you remember, during the modern architecture times, when Charles Bourley and Ethan Ludux was just approaching the idea of basic forms. Purisms, they call it purisms, yes, original form. Okay, next. The idea of progress, these are the disadvantage of that particular form. The other approach that people use, they call it structuralism, structure. They expose the structures. Like this is the mosque by Paolo Portogossi in Rome, from Italy. So this is using the structures as a forms to presenting the architecture language of the mosque. Okay. Next. Yeah, like some of the mosques in Kedah or in Sarawak. Spirit of the times, it looks advanced. Yeah, that's why if you're looking at the structural buildings, it looks advanced. Yeah. It looks modern, it looks within the times. Okay. Progressive outlook. Disadvantage that the cost to construct it sometimes is expensive. And difficult expansion, you want to expand it also, there's some issues of that. The issues of the, when you want to maintain it, also there's some issues inside that. Okay. The other one, they call it regionalism and organic architectures. Regionalism approach. So it used the local context. Like a series of Aspa mosques. Have you ever heard? Aspa mosques? Pahang. Pahang.
Asparella.
There's a one scheme of mosques designed by Jimmy Lim. Jimmy Lim, he designed a series of mosques. The Amanah Pahang. In masa Amanah Saham Pahang. So a series of mosques. It used the regionalism approach. So it is a very regionalistic approach. Those are mosques in Singapore. Itu masjid dekat Singapore. Yang sebelah ni saya punya universiti punya mosque. Universitas Indonesia. If you go to Jakarta, most of the buildings like that lah. Is following the patterns. Okay. So regionalism means you are referring to the local architecture language, and you are referring to local materials to construct your mosque. So, in Africa, in Asia, in Egypt. So there are three areas, then you produce a different type of designs. Those are the advantages of the so-called regionalism approach. Okay, that was the different type of mosque in the world, yeah? when we talk about modern mosques. Now we look at our region, because our subject was so much related with our regions in Southeast Asia. In Indonesia, as you can see there, there's a lot of style in the mosque. So, during when I did my PhD, I go travel across Indonesia. So we put the pictures, different type of mosques. We interview some of the people who architect who design the mosque, and we get we classify the mosque the types. There are at least 7 types of mosques in Indonesia. It could be 15, it could be 20, it could be 30. But as an academics, you can say it at least 7. So if you have somebody have come up with a new classification, it's okay. It's an academic, so we can always update the information. Okay. One next. They call it traditional vernacular mosque, which is traditional, a mosque which was built traditionally using a traditional materials, traditional technologies, and at the same time they're using the local materials. They were traditional and vernacular. They call traditional vernacular. But there's another thing which was traditional but not vernacular. They're using another language. Okay. This is the sample of the mosque. As I said before, Masjid Demak, Masjid Banten, Jogja, Solo, in Padang, etc. Okay, next. There's a mosque with the called foreign acculturation. It used foreign language. Like some mosque in Jakarta, he was using the Arabs. He used some Arab for the serambi, for the internal space. But the form is still local materials, but if you go to the link, they use some Middle Eastern. Some of them using the Indians, Moguls forms. Some of them using Chinese forms. If you realize some mosques in Malaysia, you can find it if we use the Chinese approach. We put a dragon, etc. Okay. Next. This is called Mogul. In Indonesia also we have Mogul colonial mosques, which is set up by the, it was built, constructed by the Dutch colonies in Indonesia. So it used a different language. It used a Mongol one. One of the reasons is that they use that as a political expression. Because local in Aceh, like this one was Masjid Baitul Rahman in Aceh, it used a different language because, you see, mosque was containing the powers for the people. Satu mos, satu imam. Ada satu imam, ada satu jawab kariah. They have their own kariah, and they have their own armies. So, in order for you to conquer, this was the Dutch strategies that you build up a big mosque. You build up a big mosque, you burn the old mosque. Yang masjid lama itu dibakar. So, if you referring to that, only happen in Indonesia. They call it mechanistic powers. Is during the Suharto times. So during suatu time, they set up a mosque called Yayasan Amal Bakti Muslim Pancasila. So they have one Masjid Demak as a typology. They construct a mosque different type in Indonesia, but only one typology. Satu masjid itu dia different size. That's why the mosque is same. It's same. The same typologies. So it has been criticized by lots of architects in Indonesia because it doesn't consider the context. Whether you put it beside the lake or you put it at the top of the mountains, it's still the same, but different size. So that's why they call it a mechanistic control by the powers. Okay, I show you before this one. Next, the use of dome, minerals, energy. So, next. So, maybe you remember this one, building by Frank Lloyd Wright. So, it shows a different approach in the designing a mosque. Next. Have you seen this one?
Yeah.
So, I think it died. I think you've been through this one. Historiography issues. I think the historiography is that people are referring to the everything happened in the past. Everything happened in the past, and during the Prophet's time, they didn't show any specific so-called architectural big architectures lah. That's why they referring that they without an architectural ambition. Yeah. Maybe we just flip through this one. The idea of architecture as a monument, as a pure art and aesthetic, also as a high technology. Cathedral is an architecture, garage is a shelters. I think most of you still think like that. Cathedral is very big, very nice, it's an architecture, but the garage is just a shelters. Our house is shelter because we didn't consider that. People say it's a pigeonhole. The pigeon, they go back, they go to the the definition of architectures. What is the definition of architectures? Yeah. If you read the Gropius, Walter Gropius' writings, he was criticizing the architects as only as an object of that particular time. I told you before, Arabia and the Rite of Islam doesn't show anything in the name of architecture. I'll show you this one to you before then. Why people build up a big mosque? Because previously people have a statue inside the mosque. When you remove the statues, then it leaves a very big space there. Okay. This is also part of when you decide the definition of mosque and everything. I believe you have gone through this one. What is Islamic architecture? What is the so-called Islamic art? You've been seeing this slide. Islam, religion Islam, Muslim, the people in the area. I showed you before this one, is it? When you cannot differentiate between the sheikh, the rabbi, also the priest and the sheikh during the in Egypt, one of them. I didn't actually see this one. So, Shiva? Okay, I explained to them. All of you just. So this is a rabbi Ibrahim bin Ezra in 19th century in Egypt. A rabbi was a Jewish priest. But I keep telling the student, if this guy coming to Malaysia, he will become the imam because of the looks. If you refer to the priest and saint during the 1919 revolution in Egypt. Also, you can see you cannot differentiate between other because during that areas, those are the clothes that they are wearing. Okay, next. We go to, that was the appearance of the people. We go to the ornamentation of the Quran and Bible in the area, in the Egypt. So you can see some of them, our Quran, also using the same ornamentations as the Coptic Bible in that particular area. Let's go architectural. Architecture. So you see the mosque, church, next. The museum, mosque and Coptic. So we're still using the same component. So there's a similarity. Thanks to Mr. Dr. Ismail Sibagaldi for the samples from the Egypt. Okay, next. Yeah, sometimes it's political, as I mentioned before, when the Dutch tried to conquer Indonesia, they're using the mosque as a political tool to control people. Like this one, Ziad, I think from your country, is it? When he was seeing that every mosque, they have their own power in the region. So by constructing a bigger mosque, then you're controlling smaller mosques. That was the idea, the political idea. And it's happening until now. If you're referring to any countries, when the state or the countries make they will make a bigger mosque. So it shows that they have bigger power than the smaller mosque. So you have the historiography, idea of architecture, idea of religious architecture, the idea of civilization in order for you to interpret the mosque. So when we talk about mosques, as I said before, during the first part of the presentation, is there any question before saya sambung lagi? Before I continue the presentation, this is the last part. I finished the two first part. Any questions before we move forward? Ada apa-apa soalan? Yang tak jelas ke? Ada? Kita bagi masa 2 minit lah, rehat lah sekejap. Boleh? Sambil-sambil kalau ada yang nanya soalan, please, feel free to ask a question. If I was speaking too fast or... Jadi nak pergi toilet? Slow pergi toilet sekejap. Tak ada? Any question? Sean? Any question? Abila, any question? Any question? Before we move forward? Have I present you this one before?
Yes.
Yang this one? Yang ini? Yang sebelum ni, yang ini dah? The values. Belum kan? I think that's not yet. Okay. So, during the first part, I was telling you the stories. What I'm trying to tell you is that mosque doesn't have any specific features to be compulsory to be put in the mosque. I show you that the dome in some other part of the world, they put the domes. Some other part of the world, they don't put the domes. Minaret also the same. In some country, they put the minaret. Some other country, you don't have the minaret. Iwan gate, you have an Iwan gate in some countries, but in some other countries, you don't have an Iwan gate. Like ornamentation also the same. Some mosques presented the form of certain form of ornamentation, whether it's a geometrical, whether it's a plant, flora type of ornamentation. In some other part of the world, we didn't show it. So what I'm trying to tell you is that mosques don't have any specific forms where you have to put certain forms. You don't have to put those. It's not compulsory to you to put the domes. It's not compulsory for you to put the minarets. It's not compulsory for you to put anything in the mosque. So mosque is really developed within the regions, with the certain type of region. So I'm showing you also, that's why when the modern architects, they have to design the mosque, they're going to display in the different forms. And as I said before, we have a revivalism, we have geometry, we have structuralism, we have a different type of approach within that thing. Okay? So, how to design a mosque? If we don't have specific requirement for mosque, how are we going to design a mosque? Amila? What do you mean by idea?
Like how
we
integrate based on the typology. Climate
and
all that. But
the,
you have to understand the
because
then you probably can.
Okay, then that's interesting. So, anyone can give any idea? Sean? Sean, how to design a mosque, Sean? I ask you to design. Depend on the client, lah. Good. How to design a mosque? If the mosque, mosque doesn't have to have a dome, doesn't have to have minarets, doesn't have to have certain ornamentation. So, how to design a mosque?
Reframe the surroundings.
Reframe the surroundings, okay. How to reframe the surroundings?
Making some interview with the community.
Tempat ni pun dia. Anybody? Bagi? Okay, because if you're referring to the previous Prophet Mosque that I show you at the first slide, they have somehow it's a mihrab. There should be some sort of directions when you want to face the Kaaba, the Qiblat. They have been some sort of indication. But the mihrab itself is an open discourse. Because in the Prophet Mosque, you won't find any enclaves. Kalau yang lama tu kan ada lengkung tu kan. Kalau our mosque, you have any enclave areas. In the Ridwan Kamil Mosque, they open it up and they put some sort of water elements there. Some people put a forest in the top of the mosque. So it is the mihrab, there should be some sort of mihrab. But the form of mihrab itself That's not yet defined. Yes? Okay. What else? Anyone? Our great designer? Okay. Oh, what do you mean? Apa maksudnya?
Maksudnya sekarang ni masjid lebih besar.
Maksudnya digunakan daripada function. Okay. Apa maksudnya? So, what I'm trying to tell you is that let's forget the form of the mosque. Yeah. Kalau kita nak, if we want to design, let's start with the values that become the inspiration of the mosque. Kita mulai dari the values dulu. Contoh macam reminder of God, ya. First value, dia reminder of God. The mosque itself should remind us of our creators. That's why the form. That's why I'm referring to apa? Frank Lloyd Wright's forms that try to connect people with the surroundings. Because Frank Lloyd says, God is the only nature is the only body of God that you will ever see. That was the statement by Frank Lloyd Wright. So in order for you to understand God, you must understand the natures. And if you referring to the Quran, you see that God is always giving the sample, like look how the mountain was standing firm, look how the camel was created, look how the certain plant of kurma or anggur to be created. They are not referring to the latest BMW 5 series. They are not referring to the latest motorcycles, the latest grade of buildings. No, they're not creating to the creators of the God. So, in order for us to remind the God, we have to have this God creating. God, creatures there, like the trees, like the waters, and etc. Okay, next. And if you look at the things spread on the earth, mountains standing firm, flowing river, fruit of every kind, human in pairs, two and two. So you see, God are referring to the His creature in the world. Okay, next. Ibadah yang berjuangan. So mosque itself is no longer becoming places for praying only. It's at the same time, it's a place for communities. Okay, next. For example, like what we call it, some is used for the praying. That was me, this saya, tahun 2002. Ketika masih putra. Tak percaya. Kenapa kurus? And some of the activities. That was an old. Next. So, you see lots of hadith relating in putting rites among the people, which is more important than praying and fasting. When you involve with the community activities, the house of worship are true community centers. So when we talk about mosque, it's not only a place for praise. It's actually a community center. In Malaysia we have Dewan Serbaguna, Dewan Orang Ramai, Dewan tidak ramai, Dewan kurang berguna. Okay, so. Mosque supposed to be placed as a community center. We have a community center, but what? Used for weddings, used for playing badminton, and also used for what? Political party meetings. Tiga tu je function dia. When I was presenting in Hong Kong, I was invited to present one paper in International Conference of Urban Sustainability in Hong Kong. I was presenting the papers on community center in Malaysia. So one of my fellow friends, Peter Zweilig from US, Houston University, he was saying that, wah, Nangkula, no wonder Malaysian were very good badminton. You have badminton court everywhere. Dewan, Dewan Serbaguna, badminton. He said, no wonder the Malaysian people are very good in playing badminton. Because you have your community center as a badminton court. Okay. Next. In the planning of the mosque, we're going to visit the Masjid Negara. If you go to Masjid Negara, I was visiting Masjid Negara on the year of 2002. I don't know whether I still keep the pictures. If you go inside, not many ornamentations. Anyone been to Masjid Negara lately?
Yes.
Tahun ini ke? So you go inside, you will find lots of embellishment of ornamentations. Yeah, sebelumnya tak ada. So I was showing you the books. Yeah? The books, history of Masjid Negara, so you can read. Then you can see original drawing of the mosque before that. Okay? If you go to Masjid Negara, you will find any fans, pagar. People can easily enter the mosque without a specific fence. Of course, there's lots of people what you are doing. Sometimes there's a dog inside the mosque, where is the mosque? There's a cat. So, you, as an architect, you have designed it in a way that those things are not coming inside the mosque, but still you have the friendly environment. So you put a fence, then you put a barrier between you and the people inside the buildings. Okay, next. Reminder of life hereafter is very important one. When I have one of my friends, Mr. Gofar, Gofar was presenting his new scheme of Islamic city in Makassar. And when I was hearing the presentations, me and my professor, first thing we asked is that, what is the cemetery? Islamic city planning. We have Islamic school, Islamic economy, Islamic commercial, Islamic areas in Makassar. It worked on, I think, like 50 or 70 acres of land, very big areas. So he was working on that areas. So first thing we asked, where is the cemeteries? Because cemetery is very important in the Islamic city planning. It reminds people to the dead. Like macam kita Bandar Kuala Lumpur kan, dekat mana dia punya kubur? Last time there are one proposal to put the cemetery down of the high voltage cable. Macam kita tengok ada voltage cable, restoran klasik kan. Dekat bawah tu kan ada atas kabel kan. So people won't stay in high voltage cable, betul tak? So they say, okay, they just let's put the cemetery at the bawah high voltage cable. Tak lah diambil tanah. Because in the Kuala Lumpur, the land was very expensive. By moving to the high voltage cable, jimatlah tanah kita. Agree or disagree? Siapa nak pindahkan ke situ? So there's a lot of people was arguing lah. They say what? See, in my opinion, the cemetery is not for the dead. People already dead, it's dead lah. You throw away pun dia tak jadi issue. But the cemetery is actually for the living. For people who live. Buddha was saying that only people who know how to die is the one who know how to live. Itu dia kata kalau if you want to live as a good person, then you know that you're going to die. Like in Muslims also, we always remind each other that. Okay, next. Cemetery must be sited so that we can view them easily within our daily pattern of life. Cemetery must be landscaped such that they are orderly and equipped with all the furniture facilities to cater the traveling ceremony as well as private visit. Okay? Okay. I'm going to show you some of the hadiths. When there is a cemetery, there's a bier past the prophet. Whenever you see a funeral procession, stand up for that until it moves away or is lower on the ground. Kalau ada orang bawa, dulu when we are child, your time mungkin tak ada lagi kot. Saya kecil dulu, when I was a small kid, bier on the way. Because people are still carrying the bier, they masih bawa, they carrying the bier from the one kampung to the cemetery to the cemeteries. So across the roads, you see the wall, lari lah, kita takut kan? People doing salawat everything. So, but actually, that was the procession where people can see. So Prophet said, if you looking at the funeral procession, people bring the bier, you have usually stand up and respect the bier, respect the dead. Until you cannot see it anymore. One day the bier was juice. Yeah, diangkat orang juice. Prophet stand up, and the companion said, "Ya Rasulullah, is a Jew." So what was the problem? He said, he had the soul before. That was what the Prophet said. Okay. Next. But in some part of the world, the graveyard become a place for worships. That's the one that people don't want it. Like, I don't know in your countries, but in Indonesia, there's lots of places where people go to the cemeteries, they pray for something. So in order for them to have something. Yeah. Next. Reminder of humilities, should be humble. There's one occasion. Yeah. Next. Have I tell you before this one? One day, people comes, Prophet was with the companion, Rasulullah dengan sahabat-sahabat dia. Orang tu tanya, siapa di antara kamu ni Muhammad? Dia tanya. So, it's a normal occasion, but architecture gives lots of impact. Why? Because it said who amongst you Muhammad means, he cannot recognize Prophet amongst his companion. But dia sama je, dia tak duduk lebih tinggi. He didn't sit higher. He didn't wear any specific clothes. Dia tak pakai crown. Dia tak pakai baju yang cantik. So it's a normal people. That's why the Baduy person want to look for Prophet, they cannot find him. So why? It's because humilities. When you design something, it shouldn't be striking with the surroundings. You humble. You should be humble with the surroundings. Because that was the man's method compared to that. Okay, next. Prophet's rooms, yeah? This is a description of Prophet's room. How the size, how humble it is. Yeah, next. When you put mosque, yeah? This is the times when people are building a high mosque, semakin besar, semakin mewah. Ornament, red and yellow decoration. There's one time that when one of the prophets, next. There's one time when the one of the companion prophet, he built up a dome house. Ada pernah dengar? A dome house. Di rumah dia ada dome. Yeah. Then suddenly that companion meet the prophet. He says, "Assalamualaikum." Dia buat muka, dia tak jawab. Dia panggil lagi, "Assalamualaikum," dia tak jawab lagi sampai 3 kali. Then prophet pergi. Then this companion was surprised lah. Kenapa? Why the prophet is not answering the salam? Salam wajib jawab kan? Dia, kawan dia cakap, one of his friends say, "He become like that because he saw your house." Tu rumah dia tu. Oh yeah. Terus the companion go back to the house, he turned down the house. Dia runtuhkan rumah tu. Then dia jumpa dengan prophet. After that, prophet say, "A building is a fitnah to the owners." Dia boleh jadi fitnah. Macam you build up a house, you build bangunan. Bangunan tu become fitnah. Wah, kaya je orang ni kan. Very expensive, dia kaya, dia very ni. Mewah kan. Very, very luxurious. So that is become a fitnah for him. Only those who need it in the house. Prophet kata, sesuatu yang diperlukan di dalam rumah. Makan, hidup. That was the necessary one. But not to monumentality, the scale, the symmetrical things. Okay, next. Public welfare, wakaf. Pernah tengok wakaf macam ni? One of the best example of Islamic architecture was wakaf. Because people are designing a building for the people. For the public to use it. That's why they call it wakaf and public welfare. Next. Distributing goods. The guests, people who in the communities. Okay, next. Street and public right. This is a very important one. Eh? Maybe some of you didn't recognize it. One day, Prophet was coming, go to the street, and a lot of his companion was talking in the street. And they chit-chat in the street. I say, okay, all of you come, they'll letak tepi. They'll letak tepi. Give the street its right, because people will want to use the street. Sometimes we have an issues when ada wedding ceremonies, ditutup jalan, ditutup berhari-hari pula. So it creates lots of issues. I don't know in your country, but in Malaysia it's very common to have wedding ceremony in the street, and you close the street for 2 or 3 days. Prof saying, give the right to the streets, because people have a right to use the street. It's not yours. Okay, next.
Cultural tolerance.
We are built up in a multicultural world. So we have to accept it. In order for us to know each other. Yesterday I meet one of the deans of Faculty of Education in what we say Islam Negeri Malang, Islamic State University of Malang. The place that you visit, what the dean of education was coming here. He said that one compulsory for their students, when you like you an undergraduate student, you're doing a degree. One compulsory thing is that he or she must teach in the international school outside Indonesia. Kena 3 bulan, 3 bulan ke 6 bulan untuk mengajar, to them to teach in the country outside Indonesia. They have sent the student to Malaysia, to Thailand, to Australia. Now they're planning to send to the some of the like Middle East, America, Europe. I asked them, why you have to do that? No, because we want our student to expose to different culture. So the paradise is not belong to their own. That was they saying lah. Because some people thought that surga itu kepunyaan dia saja. Orang lain tak ada surga kan. So, in order for us to understand different type of culture. So you are not shocked, you see a different type of culture. Like, I was lucky because I meet Haider, I meet Naif, I meet Arman. So there are 3 type of countries. The Iraq, Bangladesh. I have previously have somebody from China, somebody from Indonesia, of course, my countries. So you understand different type of cultures. So in Islam we call it a cultural tolerance, when we are respecting what we have in the world, other people. Next. And this is the one that I told you before. A funeral part in relation to public spaces. When one day there's a bier pass the Prophet and companion, very tolerant in the things. Okay, thanks. Sport and recreation, when you have sports and recreation, those are the things that Islam also encourage to have. Okay, next. The graftings, yeah? Okay, some of you have read this one. When one day people in Mecca was trying, they like to combine the trees, yeah? Ya, macam menyilangkan pokok, eh. And then for them to have a bigger, macam dia ada anggur, kan? Anggur dia makin besar. Disilangkanlah antara anggur satu dengan lain. So one day Prophet was seeing that, he said, I don't see any benefit of this. Saya tak nampak apa manfaat dia. So sahabat ni, apa manfaat Prophet tak bagilah. He thought that Prophet is not allowed you ask to do that. Okay. So they didn't do it. Then the trees was die, ya? Mati. Pokok tu mati, dia kering. Dia datanglah, so this companion come to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, you tell me before we cannot do that. Now the trees was mati. So Prophet say, some of you, some the one that I say was my own opinion. If I say this is coming from Allah, then you accept it. But it's something coming from my opinion. I also human like you all. That was the Prophet's opinion. So dia bagi pendapat masa tu. Masa dia silangkan pokok tu, dia tak cakap larang. Dia kata, saya tak nampak apa manfaat dia. So it's not saying that there's a lesson from that we can learn. Okay, next. Sometimes when you solat dia jadi imam ni, when you become an imam, dia solat panjang kan. So baca panjang. So you read long ayat in the Quran. So Prophet also say that you must say that must be brief. Kita pendekkan kalau jadi imam. Kenapa ada orang belakang, ada anak-anak, ada anak perempuan, ada orang yang ada kepentingan nak pergi. So you see, he was very tolerant in the sense of respecting other people's needs. Okay, next, sustainability. Yeah? I think this one you already know. Something related with the natures and everything. Next. Earth is a prayer's place. So, satu dua. Jadi, kita boleh solat ke mana-mana kan? Ada 2 syarat je tak boleh solat. You only have 2 conditions. One is the place when you have a najis. Dia tak clean, it unclean. Dirty, then we need to clean it up. And we can pray lah. Dia jaman pun cemetery. cemetery that we afraid that you are praying to the dead lah. Yang tak boleh solat depan. Yang lain tu boleh tak? So why we need a mosque? Kalau kita boleh solat ke mana-mana, kenapa kita perlu ke mosque? So that was the questions lah. So the mosque itself is not only a prayer place. It's actually a community development center. It has lots of functions lah. Okay, next. Ini kita dibina di ladang apa? Ladang apa? Biri-biri ya. Just bersihkan. Then dia. At this one time when the there's a cemetery there, graveyard. Dia bersihkan cemetery itu. Buat yang baru dia. It become a prayer space. It become a mosque. Accountability, this is a political, so when the leaders, next. Ini bukan. This is, bangunan apa ni tahu ya? Do you know this building?
German
Parliament Buildings, eh? Apa, Reichstag. So, when Norman Foster was designing that buildings, the previous one was burned during the World War II. Some people say Hitler burn it, some people say other people burn it. So we don't know. So, but when Norman Foster was commissioned to reconstruct the building, he built up this dome. Steel dome, replacing the old one. But the good things about the dome is that people can walk across the domes and they can see the parliament members downstairs. So kalau parliament member tengah bersidang, dia nampak lah. Buat tu, oh ya tidur. In Indonesia, we have that. Indonesia, when you have a parliament bersidang, we have reporter, students to come to the parliament. They can see their representative. When I was student, one of my projects on the modern architectures was visiting the parliament buildings. So I go there, I don't bring any letter. I want to see the survey the parliament buildings. Oh yeah, you want to survey? Okay. Dia buka pintu dia masuk. So dia masuk lah. Kami habis yang pegang dia punya hammer. So it's very open lah. During that time, 2002-2001. I don't know whether now become very close or not. We don't know. Okay. So there's accountability between the leaders and the people who lead them. Yeah, next. Yeah, this is one time when Umar bin Abdul Aziz, the president or the Khalifah during that time, the president during that time, reciting Al-Quran in the mosque. Jadi dia baca Quran dekat mosque, dia baca Quran. So ada orang nak solat, and somebody was giving ditegur, di giving advice to him to lower down the voice. People is going to pray. So it's easy. So means during that time, during Imam Umar bin Aziz, the relationship between the leaders and the follow the lay people or the normal people was very close during that time, so can easily advise the leaders. Okay, next. Yeah, this is the hadith that you can change if you think something is wrong, then you must say it, or you can do it with your power. Okay, next. Removing injurious objects. I was always saying to my students that when you build up a building, an architecture, if you build up a building and that building create a problem to the people, so the sin will come to you even you are dead. Dah mati pun bangunan tu ada lagi. As long as the building was there, the sin will come to you. You bring a problem to people. But contrary, when you build up a good things to the people, for the people, and the building is still used until now, the barakah and the pahala will come to you even when you are dying. Yeah? Okay? Next. This is one sample. Muhammad Fakri. Jatuh dari tingkat berapa? So this is a serious thing. One of my friends, my students, when he did a master's in this topic, just preliminary survey, he did a survey in Negeri Sembilan. In the last 10 years, he found 34 cases. He jatuh. Ada yang kejar kucing, jatuh. Ada yang apa? So it's a public safety lah. Yeah. Very low fence. you pick up a chair, when a kid pick up a chair, they climb up the chair. Yes. I can show you some, when we visit the JKR police barracks in Taipei, when children pick up a chair, then they are tasked. Nanti kau kan? Ah, itu yang kita kena design. That's another discussion. I can show you some design which was more safe than this one. If any one of you in the future you want to do some detailed research on this one, on the design and everything, yang student saya buat tu survey. They survey, they go to the bomba station and police station, looking at the report. They reading the reports, everything, and they come up with that issues. Next. So I think I'll show you this one. Alternative idea of mosque architectures means rock up on the mass, regional policing, etc. Okay, next. Yeah, I show you this one, this one is it?
Yes.
Yeah, one. Next. Yang ini pernah tengok tak? Apa namanya? Next.
What is this?
Okay, any question?